We're good. Good morning and happy Friday. I wanted to use PowerPoint today to show you some professional illustrations of things that I tried to draw on the board poorly in the last class, and to talk a little bit more about some of the specifics of nanomedicine and to kind of wrap up our discussion. It's a huge field. I've actually put a rather lengthy review article from the scientific literature online that if you're interested in delving into the details, you're welcome to read that, but it's not officially part of the course, although I did borrow some graphics from that paper, which were in turn borrowed from some other papers which I've cited because a professor cites their sources. Okay, so this is the article. It was written by Yunnan Shah and coworkers. This is Yunnan. He's a super famous nano engineer who is now at Georgia Tech, but was previously at University of Washington and Washington University of St. Louis, unrelated. But the same guy. And he's known for really being the graduate student who, while in George Whiteside's lab where I did my PhD, but this was 15 years previously, did all of the groundwork for soft lithography and published like 40 papers on microcontact printing. If you're looking through your exam now, can you please put it on hold until later? Thank you. And he's largely credited for the coming up with the procedures that we use for soft lithography, which is nano patterning using soft pattern transfer elements. Also, the shape selective synthesis of metallic nanoparticles. He's known for figuring out how to make wires and cubes and 1D and 3D and five-dimensional, just kidding, nanostructures of various metals and other types of particles. It's not the only one who has done this, but really has this distinction for bringing it to the forefront. And also, most recently, he's moved into the field of nanomedicine. So this is a review article. It's kind of a magnum opus that talks about many aspects of nanomedicine, particularly related to cancer therapy, which is the largest potentially impactful area of nanomedicine. And I put the review on TritonEd, and you're not responsible for it for the exam, but some of you may want to learn more about it. Okay, so this is an image that shows you the characteristics that go into the design of a nanoparticle. So we have a material. A material could be a liposome, which is like a bilayer vesicle of, it could be phospholipids or other types of structures where the polar head groups are here, then you have some hydrophobic group, and then another polar head group that goes in the interior. And again, we can either put drugs on the inside if it's water soluble, or within the bilayer vesicle shell itself, or the skin itself if it's hydrophobic. There could be a protein drug conjugate. This is an immunoglobulin or antibody, and this would bind to a cell, an antigen on a cell, and you could carry a drug along with it, and that's called conjugation when you link a drug to an antibody. Yeah.
Last time you mentioned the problem with some liposomes and other particles having burst release problem, where there was some on the surface. When you use a hydrophobic drug, would you still have that problem?
That's a good question. The question is, would you have a burst release if you have a hydrophobic drug? And absolutely, you can. In fact, it might even be more likely to have a burst release profile because hydrophobic drugs will aggregate and they'll stick to whatever they can that's not water. Yeah, that's a good question. You could have solid lipid hybrid nanoparticles. You could have, and this is a type of nanoparticle that there's a special class of this nanoparticle which is explored by Professor Zhang's group in the nanoengineering department, where you take the lipid membrane and the proteins associated with it from a red blood cell, and you coat artificial nanoparticles with those to try to evade detection. You can have hydrogels, and these could be diffusion-controlled mechanisms of release from the interior. You could have other types of polymer particles. You could have dendrimers that are three-dimensional polymers that are sort of like three-dimensional stars, where you have some group in the center, and then you progressively add branches. So then you have these monodisperse or non-dispersed particles that have these gaps in here in the interior that can actually hold drugs. And then, because everyone likes to find a use for carbon nanotubes have also been used in the research laboratory for drug delivery particles, but they're not really, there are no commercial drugs that use carbon nanotubes as the delivery agency, but who knows, the future is long and bright. And metal nanoparticles as well, and metal-coated nanoparticles that take advantage of plasmonic properties. It's just a property of nanostructured metallic materials that we'll talk about next week, once we kind of leave the discussion of bio. Shape is an important characteristic that influences endocytosis. Endocytosis is the process by which a cell engulfs a nanoparticle, and we can make different shapes. This is popularized by not necessarily approach, but this method or area of science is pioneered by Joseph DeSimone's group at University of North Carolina, where they can use the PRINT technique, that's particle replication in non-wetting templates. That's the technique that I mentioned in our discussion of unconventional nanofabrication, where you take a fluoroelastomer and you print it into a precursor, and because you have a low surface energy Teflon-like surface, you exclude all of the stuff from between the recesses in the mold. So you have isolated nanoparticles instead of nanoparticles that are connected everywhere by a thin scum layer. Literally call this the scum layer or the flash layer. It's like when I was talking about the rubber galoshes and how you have the flash layer around the rubber piece. When you make these particles, you make them like an ice cube tray, and then there's no thin sheet in between. The surface is also very important, that influences the metabolic fate of a nanoparticle and also its method of whether or not it is endocytosed. And those could be, is that a word? Sure. Targeting ligand, this could be an antibody or a peptide, an aptamer, could be like a nucleic acid, could be surface charge has an influence on the fate. Also the surface functional group, particularly whether or not it's conjugated to something else, as in the case of an antibody. And it could have a pegylation, so polyethylene glycol, which of course is wrong, it's polyethylene oxide, but we're in bio land, so it's PEG, or other coatings. All right, now you are interested, I'm sure, in what are the actual clinical uses of these particles. Is it just something that academics care about, or are these things actually used in saving people's lives? And the answer to that question is they are used to save people's lives. So this is a list that was up to date as of 2015, where we have the trade name of the therapeutic, then what kind of nanoparticle formulation it is. You'll notice that liposomal particles are by far the most well-developed commercially. So this top maybe two-fifths of the chart are approved drugs, and then some of these ones in phase two and phase three might be approved by now or close to approval, and possibly the phase has increased. Or it was rejected, which happens in clinical trials. When you look at the drugs, so we have paclitaxel, doxorubicin, paclitaxel, paclitaxel, docetaxel, paclitaxel, and so on, the same drug ends up in many different formulations. In fact, there aren't that many, relatively speaking, anti-cancer therapeutics. But most of the innovation that happens is not in the drug itself, but in the nanoparticle formulation, at least with small molecule types of drugs. There are other types of drugs as well based on proteins or so-called biologics. So note that the same drug can have multiple nanoparticle formulations. Different nanoparticles can be used to target different types of tumors. So often the mechanism of action of an anti-cancer drug or a chemotherapeutic is operative on many different types of cancer cells. So for example, paclitaxel, which is Taxol, which is the trade name of the drug, is something that targets the tubules that are involved in the ability of the cancer cells to divide and proliferate. Now that it tends to work on several different kinds of cancer cells, but it also prevents your healthy cells from dividing as well, which is why these drugs have such high such low therapeutic indices. So what do I mean by clinical trial? Well, we all have heard about clinical trials in the news, but what are the distinguishing features? So phase one clinical trials are use in healthy patients, and they're largely to determine toxicity screening, and this is 20 to 100 patients, and that's per site. Phase two, or probably a limited number of sites for phase one, maybe one site. Phase two, the patients have the targeted disease. They are placebo controlled, which means that some other group received something where the treatment was not actually present, but they got the IV or the pill or whatever it happened to be. And there are 100 to 300 patients. This could be at multiple sites, and drugs have about a 33% passing rate. So the rejection rate of drugs that reach phase two is about two-thirds. Now, per clinic, that's a lot of investment on the part of the pharmaceutical company. And whether, you know, I don't mean to be political, I'm just going to state the facts that it costs at least $100 million to do a clinical trial per site, and it has to be done at multiple sites. Phase three is extensive testing of the safety, efficacy, proper dosing, requires several thousand patients. It's done by practicing physicians. The patients spelled incorrectly, I'm gonna blame that on autocorrect, even though I'm sure it can't have been autocorrect. Patients are selected for differences in sex and ethnicity. So this is when you have to determine if somebody's from a particular part of the world, does this put them at greater risk? One trial at one center can cost more than $100 million. And where does that cost? What are the origins of that cost? And it is the manufacture of the drug at the pilot scale. For biologic drugs, this is particularly problematic because you don't get very much stuff from a culture broth. And even semi-synthetic compounds, you might have to build a pilot scale plant to manufacture the drug by multiple steps of organic synthetic chemistry in order, and separation importantly, and solvent and everything, and purity to even get you enough stuff to work with. So as a result, the new drug approval, the amount of money that it costs from conception to commercialization to where it can actually save somebody's life, the median drug costs about $2.6 billion in development. Now, this includes all of the drugs that failed. So if you have a library of compounds and you're testing a bunch of them, all of that money is wrapped up into the $2.6 billion. So you take all the R&D expenditures for a year, you divide it by the number of approved drugs, and that's the average number that you get. Some drug companies that focus on different types of And by the way, this has to be redone every time you change the nanoparticle formulation or the drug itself. Every time there's a new sort of composition of matter that you're proposing as a therapeutic, this all has to be done. And what was I gonna say about, oh yeah, some pharmaceutical companies, depending on the disease category that they're targeting, the prices can be, the cost can be much higher than this. It could be up to $10 billion, or they could be lower in the case of types of diseases that are more susceptible to therapeutic agents. There was a question over here, I'll take them in order. Yep.
So like, if yield is so low and it's very expensive to go through it, how like pure does it have to be? How much percent can pure yield allow, like versus when you're talking about MOSFET?
Yeah, that's a good question. The question is how much purity is acceptable. If the drug is not completely pure, then the side products have to be reproducible and characterized as well. For example, when you take Advil, ibuprofen is 50% inactive because it's the wrong mirror image that's present in the drug. Now, so it's 50% impure by that metric, but the impure product is not very toxic by the standards of the effective dose that you need. There are cases, a good example was thalidomide, which was, many of you may have heard of it. It was in the Billy Joel song, We Didn't Start the Fire. And one of the mirror images or enantiomers of the drug was the analgesic, and the other one caused birth defects in infants. So in that case, you would have to know that the impurity wasn't going to be harmful.
Question about phase two, placebo control of these studies.
I'm not going to know, but go ahead.
Okay, I'm just curious if what's done if you have, say, a really critical disease that people are needing some sort of treatment for. Are they just going in blind, like they don't know if they're getting a chemical treatment or what? Or is that part of the risk of being?
Oh yeah, that's something I might be able to comment on. That wouldn't be in phase two. Anytime you have a placebo control, you can't know if you get the, you could volunteer for a clinical trial under certain circumstances, but you can't know if you're getting the drug or not. So you might volunteer for it, but get the placebo, and that would suck. There's a question in the back, and then we kind of have to move on.
Oh, it's fine.
Okay. We have to move on just because I have lots of stuff, but I'm really glad that we have generated this much interest. Okay, what are some anti-cancer drugs that are currently in clinical use? So we noticed that we've divided them into hydrophobic, hydrophilic, and highly charged. And what's interesting is that the hydrophobic drug, and notice first how short this list is. This isn't the exhaustive list of compounds, but it's the one that is, but it's the list of compounds that are in most chemotherapeutic agents. So these are the active ingredients. And some of these are very old, like 50 years old. And this is an example of, so hydrophobic drugs, these are, I believe, all small molecules. And by small molecules, I mean some organic structure that you see, in the background of chemical and engineering news, the cover, and it looks like, you know, like this, like a ball and stick model. And then by small molecule, I mean it's possible to draw all the bonds on a sheet of paper, on an 8.5 by 11 sheet of paper. What's a non-small molecule? A non-small molecule is a protein or a nucleic acid. Usually it's which are called biologics. And a good example is biologics that are based on antibodies. And this is rituximab, which has a wide variety of applications in non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, but also autoimmune diseases because of the way in which it interacts with the immune cells. So the hydrophilic drugs are almost all biologics. There are a couple examples that are not. this guy is not, this guy is not, but the rest are biologics. And why would they be hydrophilic? Because something that's made of a protein has some lysine residues and aspartic acid residues that make it hydrophilic. I'm sorry, I just said hydrophobic. Biologics are hydrophilic, hydrophilic drugs. And you notice a lot of these end in MAB, M-A-B. MAB stands for monoclonal antibody. Monoclonal antibody means that it is an antibody that was produced in a culture to bind to a specific epitope of a specific antigen. So a specific molecular part of an antigen, which is a piece of some targeted cell you want to say get rid of or bind to or address in some way molecularly, and an epitope is part of that antigen. So monoclonal antibodies do not mean that they have exactly the same chemical structure, the exact same amino acid sequence, but it does mean that they bind to exactly the same epitope of a particular antigen. Clonal because they were all derived from clones of the same immune cell that produced them. Highly charged amino acids could be DNA or RNAs, and so far these are still under R&D, and they haven't made it into the clinic yet. Okay, so we divide them by hydrophobic, hydrophilicity, Taxol, paclitaxel. Taxol is the more common name used in a really wide range of cancers. As I said, this interferes with cell division, and it's interesting just from a manufacturing standpoint how the manufacturing of these drugs has evolved over time. So Taxol was originally developed, or was originally isolated from the bark of the Pacific yew tree, but then you got so little out of it and you had to distill it all that you ended up chopping down all the Pacific yew trees. So they instead made it semi-synthetically by taking another kind of tree that was more plentiful and was found in more places in the world, and then they did a couple of chemical synthetic steps to make the Taxol. Now they don't even do it that way. Now they don't have to chop down trees at all. They don't have to farm them because it's not really sustainable to do it. You use the stuff faster than you chop them down because it takes a long time for the tree to grow. So it's not even sustainable for their life-saving purposes. So now it's actually isolated from plant cell fermentation. So you ferment the plant cells, they produce the Taxol, then you separate the Taxol from it. And it prevents mitosis from binding to the tubulin of the cytoskeleton, and it's toxic to all dividing cells in the body, and as a result of its non-specificity, it produces a lot of side effects that are well known in people that are under a chemotherapy regimen. Now, when people say chemotherapy, they usually mean the drugs on this list, but usually two or more of them in a particular cocktail of a regimen. Again, drugs ending in MAB, monoclonal antibodies, and there's the definition. Okay, here is a color image of the, I'll take the question because I'm now in a new part.
I was just gonna say, so do most drugs that make it past phase two make it past phase three? Like, is phase two mostly where most drugs get stopped?
That's a good question. I honestly, that's a question that has an answer, but I don't know what it is. Drugs still fail in phase three, certainly, and those are the hardest losses to swallow, just because there's already been so much investment and so much hope too. Okay, so this is an example of polymer nanoparticles that undergo different types of either diffusion-controlled or erosion-controlled mechanisms. And this is where we have an insoluble membrane and some kind of solution in the center, or perhaps even a gel in the center. And then we have erosion-controlled mechanisms, which in some circumstances could be preferred because these particles wouldn't end up somewhere, they're completely biodegradable, but this is much harder to control because if you have something that erodes in an aqueous environment, it also probably has diffusion release as well. How about some specific mechanisms of how we take a micelle or a vesicle and break it apart in such a way as to allow drugs to be released? So if we target the drugs somehow, or we can somehow change the physiological environment around the tumor cell, we can cause the drugs to be released. In the case of polymer micelles, just to show you here, in this case, we're saying that the interior, the blue part, is negatively charged segments, and we have a positively charged drug. So the micelles might associate like this. If we decrease the pH, we will tend to protonate, just by normal Arrhenius acid base chemistry, the negatively charged segment, so that the interior no longer wants to associate with the positively charged drug, and the micelle breaks apart. You could also do this in such a way to have a scenario in which you increase the pH to take a previously neutral interior and you make it negatively charged, and the micelle breaks apart. You could have a liposome. This is a bilayer vesicle where, again, you're playing with the pH. You take these long polymer chains that are negatively charged and you drop the pH. That's adding protons in. Quench these, you neutralize these negative charges, and then you allow this no longer wants to associate with the water, so it balls up on itself, and in the process of balling up on itself, disrupts the membrane and makes it leaky so that the drugs can come out, hopefully in a controlled way. There are also ways in which you might take a cross-linked hydrogel sphere and then swell it, where its size could be controlled by the pH just based on the protonation state of the interior. Don't memorize this. Don't worry about it. It's too much organic chemistry. I just want to show you that we do know what functional groups tend to be sensitive to pH. So this is an imine, which is, if you're keeping score at home, it's an amine plus a ketone or an aldehyde to give you this N double bond C, which is easily cleaved at low pHs. Hydrazones and hydrazids work the same way, various other things. Disulfide bond, so this is the chemistry of a perm, for example, we know can be cleaved by reduction of the SS bond. Carbamates, esters, and amides can all be cleaved by enzymes. And nitrophenyl esters could be cleaved by UV light. So if you shine UV light at the site of the tumor, it could be released only there and nowhere else. So tons of different strategies to do both active and passive targeting. This is a technique that's kind of that's pretty cool for me as a polymer scientist. So we have, or polymer engineer, I guess I am, both, whatever. When you have the temperature below the something called the local critical solution temperature, these polymer chains extend out. And if the temperature rises above this this point called the LCST, sounds like a law school admission test, the polymer chain balls up. It goes from a coil to a globule. And as it becomes a globule, it behaves like a wedge in this bilayer vesicle and allows the drugs to escape. And you could do this with a solid particle that has these chains grafted to it. So the drugs are hydrophobic in this case, and they live in kind of the hair, just like head lice. And then you increase the temperature, the polymer chains ball up, and then there's no more room for the drug molecules, so they leave. So does it offend our intuition that the polymer chains ball up when the temperature is increased? Seems a little strange. That's actually an unusual property, because most molecules, when you put them in a solution, there is a large positive entropy of mixing. But there are some types of polymers in some types of solutions that have the opposite behavior. Or if you put them in solution, they become they become rigid. And in the case of a polymer, in the case of a polymer that has specific hydrogen bonding interactions with the solvent, it's so well solubilized that it actually straightens out to allow more of the water molecules to interact with it as opposed to balling up. And that's called a negative entropy of mixing, and it's an unusual property, but it's a useful property. So a lower critical solution temperature is a temperature below which the components of a mixture are miscible for all compositions. That's a lot of gobbledygook. What that means, temperature goes up, polymer balls up. In the case shown at left, we're using something called polyNIPAM. PolyNIPAM is this material, and its characteristic is that it has this this amide group. This is poly-N isopropyl acrylate. And what this does is it allows hydrogen bonding accepting here from the water and hydrogen bond donating from the amide nitrogen group. So this is a nice hydrogen bond donor. When you put this polymer in solution, it becomes rigid. And when you increase the temperature, you break up these bonds between the water and the polymer, and you allow it to shrink up. That's unusual behavior, but some polymers do it. This is a sort of a phase diagram. And don't worry, so most polymer systems follow this curve where you have an upper critical solution temperature, you raise the temperature and everything dissolves, you lower the temperature and you have biphasic mixtures. But in some cases, like polyNIPAM, you have the inverted curve. You increase the temperature above the LCST and the polymer becomes insoluble. We also have photochemically activated release. You can imagine some types of molecular groups. Don't worry about the chemistry, won't be on the exam, just the idea that there are photochemically active structures. Some of them, like azobenzene, you can add light of certain wavelength and make the azobenzene structure become like this. Then you shine a light of a different wavelength on it, and it goes back to being like this. So you can change the shape of the molecule by exposing it to light or temperature. There are photocleavage reactions, and we met this guy before. It's called DNQ diazonaptoquinone, which is the basis for DNQ-based photoresists in photoresist chemistry. But we also met one of the photoactive structures two slides ago. And then there are photopolymerizations where you can have these double bonds, and if you have some photoinitiator, they all snap together. So that's photopolymerization. There are a wide variety of ways in which polymer chains can be drug delivery nanoparticles can be taken inside the cell. And there's way too much detail here, but I just want to say that that this is somewhat well understood, but not completely well understood. Phagocytosis, caveolin and clathrin mediated endocytosis all involve proteins either exterior or interior to the cell that engulf the particle to form a vesicle inside a cell. So it's almost like having a bubble within a bubble. Some of these mechanisms are protein mediated, so they're actually part of the cellular machinery that is that knows how to take in stuff from the exterior. There are ways where we have like a pinocytosis. This is not mediated by a vesicle or by a protein. It forms a vesicle, but it's not mediated by a protein. And then in some cases you have endocytosis that is not mediated by a protein or a vesicle, like when you take a carbon nanotube and you stab it right into a cell for the reasons that you want to do that. Okay. Now here is a kind of a phase diagram, which we're showing the zeta potential, which is the, don't really worry about what that is. It's the potential difference between the aqueous environment and sort of the edge of charge of a charged species. So charge, negative charge, positive charge, more negative charge, more positive charge. Then size on this axis, and then the other y-axis is hydrophobicity. And we can see that that where we are on this plot depends or affects the metabolic fate of a particular nanoparticle. So really small particles are just literally peed out. So they just go through the pores in the kidneys, and they just exit through the urinary tract. You can have particles that are cleared by bile in the liver. In this regime, this is in the small tens of nanometers to 200 nanometers. You have you can get passive accumulation in the tumor cells by this enhanced permeability and retention, or EPR effect. And I have another slide on that in a second. MPS recognition is recognition by the immune system, which could be particles can be engulfed by white blood cells. And then high positive charge, small size, high surface hydrophobicity tend to be cytotoxic to more cytotoxic to healthy cells as well. This is a highlight of the EPR effect. So this is healthy tissue. You can see the endothelial cells that make up the inside of the blood vessel are tightly packed together. Nothing is going to get into or out, except apparently very, very small molecules. And then tumor tissue. Tumor tissue is a hack job. It's like moving into a house and realizing that all the plumbing is done wrong and all the GFC outlets need to be rewired. Not that I've ever had to do that before. But then some particles have easy access to the exterior tissue because the plumbing is done wrong and these pipes are leaky. And the lymphatic system, which is drainage of fluid from tissue, can be occluded by the presence of the tumor. So not only can the particles go in, but they're hard to get rid of too. So that's how, even though nanoparticles, even if they're not targeted at all, if they're the right size, they can still accumulate in the tumor tissue due to this this effect of leaky plumbing and bad drainage, like Manhattan in 1890.
Professor?
Yeah.
Is that EPR effect pretty universal across all types of tumors, or is that more common in specific?
The answer that I can be most confident in is that it's common to most tumors, but of different degrees. So these nanoparticles can be cleared from the bloodstream. Now, clearance in drug delivery means cleared from the bloodstream, not necessarily from the body, unfortunately. So sometimes you can have particles that are completely eliminated from the body, but in other cases they accumulate. So the EPR effect helps particles accumulate in the tumor. In the blood, the clearance of small particles is enhanced because of the effect of the kidneys. So a particle is less than 8 nanometers, it can exit permanently through the toilet. The spleen will trap particles that have very large sizes. Now, this is not good for the spleen, but in the case where you're going to die of cancer or have stuff accumulated in the spleen, this might be okay. The liver has several mechanisms by which it can get rid of cells, either get rid of nanoparticles, either by direct filtration or by conversion of these nanoparticles into bile, or placement in the bile, the gallbladder, then the stomach, then again out. This is an article that came out a couple years ago that sort of just shows you in a different way the effects of size and shape and surface charge on where they end up. Don't worry too much about it. You can look this up if you'd like. And there's quite a long bit here that I don't want to read because of time. Okay, here is the internal architecture of the kidneys, and we have these fenestrations, like the defenestration of Prague that started the 30 Years' War, and these particles can exit and then go to the bladder. nanotubes. Again, this is not, these are not part of commercial drugs yet, but nanotubes, carbon nanotubes, have also been nanotubes, otherwise known as rolled up graphene. If I were to explain this 5 years ago, I would have said that graphene is unrolled carbon nanotubes, but now because graphene is all the rage and nanotubes ain't, then we have to explain it in the backwards direction. So you can conjugate things to carbon nanotubes by hydrophobic interactions. So just by this simple van der Waals force of these hydrocarbon chains will associate to the carbon nanotube, and you can conjugate Taxol, one of the most famous therapeutics, to this chemical group, and then you can see that in mice, the tumors grew the slowest in the presence of these carbon nanotube conjugated to Taxol. And if you take the liver and the spleen out of sacrificed animals, you can see that indeed the nanotubes accumulate in the liver. So this is a section made by microtome, and you get these bundles of carbon nanotubes that end up in the liver. But the authors were, and in the case of nanotubes, targeting was achieved by the EPR effect, and the carbon nanotubes were observable in the liver after sectioning, but the authors were quick to point out that no obvious damage was noticed, except for the carbon nanotubes. By like 500 milliseconds, beat you. Yep.
Are carbon nanotubes carcinogenic?
Are carbon nanotubes carcinogenic? Probably, I don't know. I think the jury is still out. It depends on the size and the shape and how they're ingested, or I would say that under some circumstances they might be, but I wouldn't want them in my body. Yeah.
Kind of related to that, is there, you say the drug can easily adhere to it through hydrophobic effects. Is there a concern that nanotubes, once in the body, once they've delivered their payload, so to speak, they could pick up other troubling things and then just kind of cluster them up in the liver?
That's a good, the question is, can carbon nanotubes pick up other stuff? What is the metabolic fate of a carbon nanotube after it's delivered its payload? I don't know. The liver is pretty good at filtering them in, so to speak. Shape. I alluded to this earlier, that the endocytosis is dependent on the shape of the particle. So we can make these little children's toys that are either, you know, circular or spherical, or like parallelepipeds, or these things that have a little meniscus on them. And what they found is that rod-like particles enjoy an appreciable advantage when it comes to internalization rates, reminiscent of the advantage that many rod-like bacteria have for internalization in non-phagocytic cells. I don't know if that hypothesis has ended up being true, but that it's reminiscent of rod-like bacteria, but there it is. And this is an example from our own department of nanoengineering, where one can take red blood cells and do a hypotonic treatment, which hypotonic means if you put cells in a low salt environment, because the electrolyte concentration is so much higher in the cells that by osmotic pressure, the water will go into the cells to equalize the chemical potentials, and the cell will burst. Then you extrude the particles, and they form these bilayer vesicles with all the cell machinery gotten rid of, and you just have the vesicles. Then you combine them with polymeric nanoparticle cores, and now you have polymer nanoparticles that are cloaked in a way with these red blood cell coatings, and they can be a way to extend the lifetime of particles in the biological environment in the bloodstream. Okay, I just want to show you some neat pictures to wrap up the discussion from Monday about DNA nanostructures. So we can actually use DNA in some cases to do stuff that is useless so far, but generates really great SEM images. So this is an example of bottom-up nanofabrication versus top-down fabrication. So self-assembly of DNA nanostructures can give us periodic patterns in a way that are additive as opposed to subtractive, soft, potentially large area, and not cheap yet. Okay, so we can this is an oldie but goodie. Full DNA to create nanoscale shapes and patterns. And the idea is if you take a DNA and you take some DNA staples that are just short polynucleotides that bind to specific segments, you can program in a computer the two-dimensional shape that this DNA is going to fold into. And you can create things like squares, two rectangles together, stars, smiley faces, triangles, and other kinds of triangles. This is the coolest thing ever. Now imagine that you knew you were gonna try to do this, right? And you knew that you were gonna make the structure that self-assembled into a smiley face, but imagine actually going to the SEM microscope and actually seeing this on the screen. Amazing. I mean, some of them have like elephantitis and stuff, but you know, some of them are. All right, you can also make a map of the globe where all of the continents are North and South America. You can make a band, this is the most politically incorrect 15 seconds of the class. DNA, and these other things. You can also do self-assembly of things that are self-assembled. So hierarchical self-assembly. Some of this work was actually done at UCSD by former faculty member Jennifer Cha. Now at Colorado, and you can take these DNAs, you add little primers, and they form these structures, and then you can use top-down photolithography, in this case making surfaces hydrophilic, and then the structures end up in the hydrophilic patches, or they end up in depressions. So here, so just these relief structures that are carved into this film, and if you have the triangles oriented down in the template, all the triangles point down. If you have them pointed up, they tend to point up. If you line them up into stripes, they form into these stripes, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. I don't know what they were doing here. Like, nope, that's an error. I can see that. And then again, they end up in these trenches or furrows. If you have shapes of different types that can be formed by triangles, kind of like a children's toy, they will actually line up with some amount of halfway decent yield, sort of. Yeah, pretty good at finding the one spot. This one's a massive fail. And you can also make metallic nanoparticles on the corners of these triangular structures where you can order them in a plasmonically useful way. So if you want to make an optical surface by taking these gold nanoparticles, you can conjugate them by having this polyadenine and polythymine tail, and the A's and the T's will bind together so that the A's are on the corners and then the T's are on the periphery of this gold nanoparticle. You add them together, and what do you get? Are these things that bind to the corners of the triangles. Then you take the corners of the triangles, and then you take the depressions that you make or the chemical functionalization in the surface, and they end up in a perfect world in these idealized arrays where you can, in principle, calculate with some amount of determinism where these gold nanoparticles end up on the surface. and here's what they look like. So in dark field, or this is SEM, sorry, it's not dark field. This is a SEM image, and you can see that the conductive gold nanoparticles are indeed at the corners, and you get fairly decent registry. You know, you can tell this is not perfectly ordered, but it's not random either, because random is like constellations where things are bunched up. Office hours, I already went through this. They're going to be at 2 p.m. today in my office, and we're out of time, but I can answer it if it's yes or no.
I'm just curious about, you might have a temporal resolution, but do you think it's plausible?